All right. Good afternoon. Exciting Daquan. We're glad to have you here this afternoon. And just going to have a couple of quick announcements before we begin worship. I don't know if this is true or not, but I've been told that if you're worried about exposure to COVID, the closer seats are safer than the ones farther back. I don't know if that's true or not, but I'm just saying that just in case. If any of you want to move up, you're welcome to do that. One of our speakers feels very far away to everybody when you're staring, you're looking at a bunch of empty rows, and I thought that'd be funny. Maybe it wasn't as funny as it thought it was going to be. So the other announcement is, I think the ladies had finished up their Bible study until the end of the summer last week, so try to encourage one another when you can online or through phone calls or through chats as often as you can, and just to keep building one another up. Me and I have no idea where we are or how we're doing, but we are also taking a break. I believe that they're really requesting and encouraging those meeting in small groups to not do that right now, just for being safe. So we're going to follow those guidelines. But again, if you can talk online or through phones or through chatting or whatever, please encourage one another throughout the week. Let's don't let ourselves distance spiritually, physically, and for medical conditions, that's maybe good, but in our spirit, we need to be together and need to be unified. So let's encourage one another when we can. This morning, we're going to sing a couple of songs. I don't always introduce the songs before we start, but in my mind, I kind of, as I was choosing them, they kind of say a little bit of something. And Christian songs can always say something because they're all with the same message about loving God. I mean, there's a little bit of differences of variation, but we're starting this morning saying, "I Can Only Imagine." And it's kind of the story of what will it be like when we see God face to face? I can only imagine. And then the next song is Glorious Day. Well, that will be a glorious day when we finally get to see him face to face. And we can see him face to face because he died for us. So it's, we can only imagine, but it's going to be a glorious day. And then we're going to talk about how Jesus overcame and why it will be such a glorious day. So those are the songs that we're going to be singing this morning. And if you would stand with me, we'll sing this first song together. And then after that, if you'd like to sit, that's fine. Or if you want to continue standing, however you feel led. Only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Only imagine, surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. And I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing
hallelujah. Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. Yeah, surrounded by your glory, but what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. And I can only imagine a virgin dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us. His glory revealed, and living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. Oh, one day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. And one day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. And hands that healed nations stretched out on a tree, and he took the nails for me. And living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away. And rising he justified freely forever. Oh, one day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered, and now has ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death could not hold him. The grave could not keep him from arising again. And living he loved me, dying he saved me, and buried he carried my sins far away. And rising he justified freely forever. seated above, enthroned in the Father's love. Destined to die, poured out for all mankind. And God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if he did. And all authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome and power forever, awesome and great is your name. You overcame. Power in hand, speaking the Father's plan, sending us out, light in this broken land. And all authority, every victory is yours. All authority, every the blood of the Lamb and the word of our test. Everyone overcome, and we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. You're awesome and powerful forever. Awesome and great is your name. You overcame. And you overcame. You overcame.
Amen. You may be seated.
Are there any prayer requests today? Stouts, okay. Anybody else? I have one myself. My workplace has been a bit rough this week, and I was talking with my boss about possible futures, and one of the ones that might end up is I might not be able to stay my whole contract with my boss, but we will see where that ends up. Okay. Yep. For Brother Lee?
He's in the hospital.
Okay. Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah. Anything else? Yeah. Okay, we'll pray for your whole family then. Is that everyone then? Thank you. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear Jesus, I just want to pray for everybody now in these trying times. We've had lots of difficulties this year, and everybody be safe and in your hands. And Lord, pray that this will be a time to come together and to bond as a family and bond with you, Lord. Pray for my own situation, for the workplace, and for people in Korea that are looking at employment and wondering what's going to happen next. Lord, I want to pray for Brother Lee, who's in the hospital, for his health and recovery, and I pray that he would come out quickly and be safe and in your hands, and pray that he comes out with a new vigor for life and for you. Lord, I want to pray for everybody's families, for people who have passed away in the times recently, and pray for people who are grieving and sad, and for the sick and dying. Lord, this is a time of a lot of sadness. May it be sadness that helps people ask questions and grow in love with you. Thank you, Lord, for being with us and being over top of us and just staying with us through all the troubles and knowing what our pain feels like, for you felt it first. Amen.
Afternoon. Okay, now let's read today's scriptures. So I will read one verse and you do the next one. Okay. Today's scripture is Exodus. And I say to you, let my son go, that he may serve me. If you refuse to let him go, behold, I will kill your firstborn son. Then Zipporah took a flint and cut off her son's foreskin and touched Moses' feet with it and said, surely you are a bridegroom of blood to me. Let's read together. So he let him alone. It was then that she said, bridegroom of blood, because of the circumcision. Thank you.
You know, I have to admit that last time I preached, I was a little distracted. And I think I've narrowed down the problem with the live streaming. It's whenever I'm going to preach, something's going to go wrong. And I think the message the last time I preached was about who God is. Everything that's wrapped up in that statement, I am. And I think today's message has a lot of weight. I feel like before we really get into chapter 4, so before we start talking about the first part or what comes after that strange part in the middle, it would be best to understand what in the world that strange part's talking about. Deal with the elephant in the room, so to speak. Because I don't think that it is meant to be a distraction. It's not a distraction from the message, but it's closely linked to the whole purpose of the message. So unlike the distraction for me with the live stream that's trying to keep me from focusing on what I'm supposed to be saying up here, this is a good distraction. And I hope that by looking at it, we can learn more about God. We can learn more about the gospel. So let's start there. Look at those verses in the middle, verses 24 through 26 of chapter 4 in Exodus. And we'll read it again here. It says, "At a lodging place on the way, the Lord met him and sought to put him to death. Then Zipporah took a flint and cut off her son's foreskin and touched Moses' feet with it and said, 'Surely you're a bridegroom of blood to me.' So he let him alone. It was then that she said, 'A bridegroom of blood,' because of the circumcision." Now, I don't know about you, but that last little part was put in there to kind of bring a little bit of clarification. But when I read it, I'm like, that doesn't really add much clarification to my mind. And truthfully, most scholars, when they look at that passage, don't really have a lot to go on to get more clarification themselves. It seems like, even to people who study the Bible for a living, that it's out of place. Because we see this awesome, powerful story, working towards the Exodus, working towards the fulfillment of this promise that God made. Moses had just met God on Mount Sinai. And God, in the beginning part of chapter 4, gives him signs that he can show to basically prove to people that he really did talk to the great I Am, the real God. It's like this powerful buildup. And you'd think, that's amazing. If someone came to me and doubted that God was real, and I asked God for signs to prove to them that it was real, you would expect something different from the very next verse. And we see this, that the Lord met him on his way to do what he had just commissioned him to do, to be the leader from slavery into the promised land. On his way to do that, the Lord met him and sought to put him to death. There's all kinds of questions that are going to flood to your mind. And when you look in the Hebrew, there's even more questions that pop up. Because when you look in the original language, you can see that Moses' name actually isn't even in those verses. So a lot of our translations make it clear that this is talking about Moses But in the original language, you have to use the context to come to that conclusion. So was it even talking about Moses? And which of Moses' sons was this talking about? You know, when you look at the verses right before, which we read during the scripture reading, it talks about Pharaoh and his firstborn son. And so you think, okay, well, this is something to do with Moses and his firstborn son. So that's the point that is trying to be made here, the significance of that. But we don't know. It doesn't say it's his firstborn son. It doesn't say which son it is. Okay. Feet. Moses' feet in your translation. In the Hebrew, that's a euphemism for some other appendage of a male. And so some people say there's some significance to that, that maybe it's not talking about feet. If that's not strange enough, what is Zipporah talking about? This phrase, bridegroom of blood, what in the world does that mean? When we come to hard passages like this, passages that don't have all the answers to the many, many questions that we have, our tendency would be to just skip over them or to downplay them or say something like, I'm not really sure what this means, so let's move on. Today, I'm not going to go into all of the details because I don't think that's important for understanding the point. If you don't have the details, then they weren't important to understand the point. But I feel like if we ask the right questions, we can understand the significance of why this is in this story. And we'll come to some pretty powerful conclusions that are worth our time digging in deeper, even if all of our questions aren't answered. So keep that in mind. I'm not trying to answer all those questions, because the answers aren't there. But there are some answers that are there. And when we think about understanding the point, we can see that for Moses' family at least, death was not too extreme of a punishment for one of his sons not being circumcised. Okay? So we know that. We can go into the passage knowing that. Death wasn't too extreme of a punishment because one of his sons was not circumcised. And we can see that, however, this was the case. I'm not sure. Nobody really knows. Maybe it was because her father was a high priest. Zipporah knew that in that moment, without, at least in the text, anybody saying, this is what God wants, this is why God's going to kill. Zipporah knew that circumcision would assuage God's wrath. That would satisfy God and he wouldn't kill in that moment. She saved a life. Whoever it was, I think it was Moses. She saved Moses' life by this act of circumcision. So to understand the point of why that passage is in this section of verses, we need to understand how circumcision could play a more important role in a believer's life than even the mission which God had ordained them to do. He is on his way to do what to help fulfill this promise that has been talked about for generations and generations. God just gave him signs to do it. God encouraged him that he was the right one to do it and that he could do it, that God would be with him. That's the uniqueness of his name, that he would be with him in this process. And he's going along, and then all of a sudden, that can all be uprooted because his son wasn't circumcised? Now, I'll say here, because you've heard me say the word enough, that you're probably feeling a little bit uncomfortable. I am not going to go into any details about what specifically or how to circumcise, what circumcision is. 4 is the same type of death that would threaten us if we take this sign of the covenant, circumcision, if we take it too lightly. I guarantee that death is just as much a risk. Yet, how many sermons in your life? Promise isn't the thing that we're confused about. As modern day Christians and Gentiles, we understand what the promise was. We've talked about it. We see the correlation to Christ. The mention of circumcision is important. And there's a lot on the line for Moses if he doesn't take it seriously. For any person of God, if they weren't to take it seriously. But I'd say especially for this man whose role was to lead that Exodus, to lead people out of slavery, out of that bondage. How can you do that if you haven't taken that sign of the covenant seriously? For Moses to be the leader of something that he hasn't taken seriously in his own family is a significant thing. For Moses, the one who's supposed to lead the people out, to be cut off from those people is a serious, serious thing. And I think it's important for us to see in this context where this happens. That he had already come to an understanding that it was the real God. It was the I Am that had spoken to him. And could you say that in your life? That you've had that one-on-one meeting with the I Am, the great I Am, the one true God. And perhaps even have been sent on a mission, similar to Moses. You already got the game plan. You know what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to be leading people towards freedom. Returning to Egypt to take up his appointed role of representing the Lord to Israel and to Pharaoh. He was God's representative. He therefore had to be faithful in God's requirements. There was to be no discrepancy between what he enjoined to others and how he acted himself. And I hope you're starting to see the significance here. So what's at stake that night was Moses' fitness to be the Lord's representative. If he's not fulfilling God's requirements in his own life, then how could he be the one to tell other people to do that too? And maybe you're sitting there wondering, when's he going to stop talking about this? Or maybe you're sitting there wondering, is circumcision even important